In 1994, a hurricane sweeps across the North Atlantic. A towing convoy with the tugboat Neftegas 52 and the former transatlantic liner, then called American Star, in tow, passes the Canary Islands in heavy seas. The towing cable breaks for the third time, the American Star breaks free, and the tugboat leaves it to its fate. It turns away. On January 18th, the disabled ocean liner runs aground on the coast of Fuerteventura. This is the end of the luxury liner built in 1939 as the America, once the pride of the United States lines. Puerto Rosario, the capital of Fuerteventura. We want to know from the head of the port authority what happened that night.
So in reality, not everything is clear regarding the stranding of the American Star. It is believed that the ship towing the American Star lost the tow line in the storm. It was a severe storm, and instead of informing our sea rescue service, the crew on the tug apparently preferred to take in the remaining crew members on board. It is assumed that there are four people involved. After that, the tugboat left the scene of the accident and left the American Star to its fate.
Due to the rough sea, the ship eventually ran aground on Barlowerty Beach, where its remains are now located.
Over time, the wreck was pushed further onto the beach. A sandbank grew around the ship. When the tug was seized, it was already near Agadir, Morocco. There, they were instructed to return to Spanish territorial waters to clarify how the accident happened and why they had not notified the search and rescue service.
The Ukrainian towing company Neftegaz refused us an interview regarding the allegations made against them. Their reason was that everything had already been resolved. When the American Star broke apart in rough seas on the second day after grounding, her fate was sealed. A salvage company from Germany could only confirm the total loss. Salvaging the remains of the ocean giant would have been too costly and would have far exceeded the purchase price of $1 million paid 4 months earlier. The American Star had broken apart right at the large staircase and elevator shafts behind the engine room. This is the weakest point of the ship's construction. Like a gigantic breakwater, the wreck is now exposed to the sea. When the authorities and owners gave up guarding the wreck, the islanders literally took possession of it. Swimming out, they tried their luck despite the dangers it entailed. The 28-meter-high ladder that had been welded for the transfer to the ship leads up to the promenade deck, a laborious, dangerous path, just like the 300 meters that must be swum out to the wreck. These dangers had to be avoided because the weather conditions on the north coast of Fuerteventura are very unpredictable. A cable car was needed, so they stretched two 400-meter-long ropes from the deck to the shore, built a suspension with an old car seat, and made their way using muscle power. The bronze portholes were removed from the cabins, brought on deck, and collected for transportation to the shore. Getting to the shore required a significant amount of courage and willingness to take risks. Yahoo! What happened to the removed ship's inventory? In a backyard, treasures that make a collector's heart beat faster are still stored even after years. Ibrahim Quintana retrieved everything himself or together with a friend in months of work from the wreck. He had plenty of time because he was unemployed back then. Everyone who emptied the ship in those days was unemployed, says Ibrahim. On the island, a lively trade developed with finds from the wreck. Everyone who managed to get something tried to sell it. Those who worked on the wreck were called el loco de barco, the crazy one from the ship on the island. Here, a 30-year-old deck chair made of teak wood. In a cupboard, various hinges. In a drawer, clothes hooks. In the other corners, dusty furniture and a jumble of items of all kinds. They just need to be refurbished, Ibrahim says. A megaphone. In the garage, the copper frame from the entrance to the theater of the former America. A control panel and one of the rotor discs from the bridge.
There are many things from the ship here, but also some personal items. These here, for example, are alarm systems that were installed in the corridors against fire hazards. These lamps here, they were installed on the decks. More lamps from the sleeping rooms in the cabins. And lamps from the corridors in the cabins. This here is a chair from the luxury suite. They were the best furnished. And this is a telephone system. I don't really know what function it had. And here is more lamps. In this drawer, there are things that I have multiple times. Fire alarm switches, for example. They're dirty, but if you clean them, they are very nice pieces. These tables, they're also from a ship. This here, this is a corner shelf from the captain's cabin. He probably had a plant in it. Let's move on here. This, it was outside on the deck. I think it has something to do with the steering mechanism. Here I have a lot of postcards from the ship from the time when it was called Italis. Very, very many, 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 enough to write to America with them. This console here, it's also from the ship. And down here I also have light switches and many other electrical devices. Let's see what else I have here. Ah, yes, here, these are door signs from the bathrooms, men's and women's. These are manometers and such display devices. This is a toilet paper holder from Bath and hinges from the doors, all made of brass.
find furniture from the America. Among this chaotic jumble, however, stands the ship's bell. While clearing out the wreck, Ibrahim had a dream. He has since fulfilled it. With the items salvaged from the wreck, he has set up a cafeteria in Puerto Rosario. Ibrahim is proud that there are only originals from the former America in his cafeteria. Items from other ships would have no place here. Ibrahim wants to create an honorable memory for the great old lady, without whose stranding this cafeteria would not exist. Not only dismantling, but also the restoration of the finds have consumed a lot of money and time. In the kitchen stands one of the original refrigerators from the America. With great effort, it found its way into the cafeteria. Also, only parts of the America were used on the outside. The entrance door was once the ship's fire door number 182. The windows were mounted on the promenade deck. We want to return to the wreck one more time. It is the year 1994. The island residents documented the events themselves on film. They now relied on machine power instead of muscle power. An old car could be converted into a winch. The tires were removed from the rim, and the pulling rope was now guided over the rim to the wreck. This allowed people or material to be transported back and forth using the forward and reverse gears. Simple yet efficient, because the wreck had now become a job creation site, and speed was of the essence if one wanted to retrieve the last remnants from the wreck. The torn-off stern has shifted 6 meters from the bow section in the last 3 months since the stranding. This change is most noticeable at the seaward break. This is where the grand staircase and elevators were once located. The powerful Atlantic swell relentlessly separates the stern from the bow. The still several centimeters thick steel plates of the decks are ultimately no obstacle for it. The sports deck did not withstand the strain for long and collapsed upon itself. The first-class ballroom with the valuable original mural by Charles Baskerville, which could no longer be saved. The ballroom also collapsed the following night. The promenade deck at the aft side was deteriorating increasingly faster. The last connection between the aft and the bow, with a view into the promenade deck, was now severed. The brig on the landward side was widening faster and faster under the force of the waves, and the aft was listing more and more. The lower decks were increasingly underwater. The sea had forcefully carved a path from the seaward side to the beach through the ship. Below the D-deck, staying was already life-threatening. The crew's mess hall was just a plaything of the tides. Through the open portholes, the waves could make their way inside unhindered. Anyone who stayed here had to expect that the sea would mercilessly claim them. Two young islanders met their end here.
But dangers lurked not only on the wreck itself, but also from the land.
The ship lies on military terrain, and there the Spanish Navy and Air Force conduct shooting exercises, regardless of the men on board.
More or less accidentally, a projectile hit the chimney of the America. No one was injured, as the ship had been evacuated in haste. Ibrahim Quintana set out to dismantle the art historically valuable murals in the Theater of America. A difficult undertaking to bring the six parts of this 8-meter-high painting ashore intact. One could never be sure whether to leave them to the sea or not when they were hanging on the cable car. But Ibrahim succeeded. He himself still owns 3 paintings. The rest he shared with his colleagues. In one room, we discovered something on the floor that we hadn't expected. There lie original works by Charles Baskerville from 1946, which he had created especially for the America, an artist whose works are now exhibited in the Museum of Modern Art in New York. He said the first thing he looked at was the date, says Ibrahim, and he dismantled everything that was old. Then he shows us more murals that he took off board in 1994, testimonies of modern American art in a shed on Fuerteventura. The old transatlantic liner still lies on the sandbank and has lost some of its former glory. Rust is spreading and covering the ship with a patina. But the sea could not take away any of its former attractiveness, even though it has already swallowed the stern. The America continues to defy the whims of the element it once sailed. Its past and the many names it bore will not let it be forgotten so quickly. 1939. SS America, Agnew United States Lines. 1941, USS West Point, Troop Transport, Agnew United States Navy. 1946, again America, Agnew United States Lines. 1964, Australis, Agnew, Camarus Lines. 1978, for 4 months, America, Agnew Venture Cruises. 1978, Italis, Agnew Handelsplatz. 1980, Noga, own Intercommers Corporation. 1984, Alferdos, own Silver Moon Ferries. 1994, American Star, own Chappelle Transport Company of Thailand.
America still has a magical pull on people. Even now, people risk their lives trying to get closer to it. Treacherous currents constantly change around the wreck. Treacherous are the decayed decks on board. Too many dangers for the risky attempt to maybe grab a souvenir from the cleared-out ship.
I am the Lord.
If I remember correctly, 8 people lost their lives. Some were just seeking adventure and swam to the ship. These people didn't account for the force of the tide and were thrown against the hull. Others walked to the ship at low tide to get onto the wreck and take a look. But they didn't pay attention to the rising tide, and when they wanted to return to the shore, the water was too high and the current too strong. The undertow is the most dangerous. They couldn't assess that. And so they were pulled into the sea by the undercurrent. This current is caused by the broken-off stern. We had to rescue at least 11 people from various situations. Some couldn't get back on board. We had to bring them ashore by helicopter.
And his friend left the wreck too late and are now caught in the tidal change. Although the two are among the experienced men of the first hour and know the wreck like the back of their hand, it becomes dangerous for them. The current is driving them more and more towards the edges of the stern that juts out of the water. If their strength fails now and panic sets in, the men are lost. Jorge is pulling a plastic bag secured with a buoy behind him, and although his friend is already exhausted, he first brings himself and the bag to the safe shore. Only now does he take care of his comrade who is still struggling with the flood. Possibly be in this bag that almost cost them their lives. Nothing more than a bronze valve, like the kind you can buy from any plumber. You can melt it down and cast figures and small bells from it. Sounds good, he says. In Hawker's workshop, items from the America are stored, ranging from the deck chair and toilet bowls to the refrigerator. Also a motor from one of the elevators. With 2 wires, he puts it under tension to demonstrate that it still works even after 60 years. In front of the workshop, a jumble of other finds. In the living room is the spare wheel.
Next to it, a piano from the Salon of the America, built in 1939. Behind the workshop lies one of the lifeboats. The display screen of the radar system with its associated electronics. But where's the antenna gone? We find it 20 kilometers away on another property where its owner has left it since 1994 and doesn't know what to do with it. Maybe someday you could make big money with it. After all, it's quite old. So on Fuerteventura, you can find a bit of America on almost every corner. Some are waiting for the big money, while others prefer to throw things away.
The Wrack is owned by the Ministry of Defense. The former owner had abandoned the ship and left it to the insurance company. They had no interest in it either, so it ended up in the possession of the Ministry of Defense. The ministry auctioned the ship to a Greek and set deadlines for waiting. Since these deadlines were not met, the permits expired and the ownership rights reverted back to the Ministry of Defense. They are still the owner today.
Who was this Greek and what did he intend to do with the wreck of the America? One person who had dealings with him is the artist Klaus Behrens, whom we met at his America exhibition in Puerto Rosario.
So the Greek was here on the island and he wanted to scrap the ship. And then one day he showed up and started spreading the word that all the people involved would be prosecuted. So legally, those who had taken parts from the ship and so on, but according to maritime law, nothing can be done because he only bought it from the Navy later when the ship was no longer guarded. He had a very large project planned. Specifically, he wanted to practically the rear 110 meters, the stern,
should be scrapped, demolished. And from the proceeds of this scrapping action, the front part, which was to be made seaworthy, would then become a beautiful museum for the Mediterranean, which would then always be a temporary tourist attraction in certain parts of the Mediterranean. He tried to recruit people, yes, so to cut this ship into pieces. But the people here said, that's impossible, he's crazy, I will never sit in the surf with a blowtorch. That was totally absurd for them, they made so much fun of him. But he continued with the project, also tried to find people on the Spanish mainland, that is in Andalusia and the south. And then he had the problem that from time to time some bad news would go through the press that they had taken people off the ship who couldn't get back. And then some people also had accidents, died in the waves or were thrown against the ship's side. Some eventually drowned. He then disappeared from the island and, as I said, left in peace. But the barracks from the legion that he got to house his Greek workers, whom he wanted to fly in later, are still up on the cliff today, as you might have seen. And yes, that was basically the story with Nicholas the Greek, El Greco.
Klaus Behrens has been living in Fuerteventura for 15 years. He showcases in his exhibition Renewal Parts, SS America, items from the America that he personally salvaged from the ship and transformed into artworks. His exhibition has been shown in various cities across Europe, in Germany in 1998, at the German Maritime Museum in Bremerhaven. The entire medical documentation from a voyage of the America has been turned into a work of art. The artist salvaged these reports from the ship's infirmary. Klaus Behrens also found the complete construction and renovation plans of the America on board. They are important for a new major project that he wants to involve us in. Once the old America is supposed to shine in the light of glory.
Here are these two doors.
Here, at this height, is also the ladder, which is strongly and firmly welded from a sidewall.
It leads up to the promenade path.
This is the ladder that we also want to use to venture into the wreck. Klaus has received permission from the authorities to take us on board. One day before, we want to take another look at the wreck that we last visited a year ago. There is now a hole in the bow. After a year, the sea has created a new passage. We don't know what it looks like on board now. The ship lies there as if it were anchored. Klaus and his assistant Dieter Volz are also on the beach.
Now you're sitting up top, now you're packing on the promenade deck, and later these generators, which weigh about 30, 40 kilos, have to be lifted up there. But with the three of us, we'll manage somehow, and what's really important is when we go into the rooms tomorrow, because the doors are either open or ajar. And the ship is practically at a tilt. That means when you go into the tilted rooms, if you install the lamp somewhere, always place a wooden block underneath if the door is inwards, in case it closes. If you're inside and it closes because everything is tilted, then it's like a cork in a bottle. You can't open it again.
The next day, the security forces are there too, who are supposed to accompany us on board during the mission. Don Felix, the head of the Port Authority, didn't want any more dead bodies in this wreck. Now it's up to the chief of the fire department and the lifeguards from Parara to decide if it's feasible or not.
No, it's not advisable to go to the wreck at this time. Yeah, we now have 2-meter swells and it's going to get worse later. It would not only be difficult to get you on board, but also all of your equipment. It's better to wait a day until the wind gets weaker.
Exactly.
Just like that. Yes. Let's pack all this up nicely again.
And then we have to try that again. The sea is just the sea. You can't calculate that.
Again, nothing.
Yes, but it's not the last day yet. Yeah, for sure. All the preparations and all the joy and stuff, but externally, if the weather goes, no.
Okay, then here's two.
Vienna to Vienna or Kassel?
Yeah, off home then.
Yeah. No, he said we can fill it up in the foreland now. So, like, as soon as something happens, because he says it can change from one day to the next, it can practically dissipate overnight, the storm. The next day is good then, so don't call him immediately. Otherwise, we are immediately with him that on Friday evening, because Friday is a full moon, on the second evening, we get the exact data from the weather station again for Saturday. Because one day before, the full moon and one day after are practically the times when it recedes the most. And then there is even the possibility of simply packing the stuff with a larger life raft. And you can therefore practically bring them to the culprit. Because only this channel forms in front of it. And now we might try to get the exact data again on Friday. And then it might be that we do it on Saturday. Assuming the weather changes, but usually at full moon the weather changes. Stop laughing. But be disappointed, because it is clear that this is not an easy undertaking to make this story.
And as the listener already says, that is the boss, and if you don't follow him, you are lost.
It was only 2 weeks later that the weather calmed down. The equipment is packed watertight. The decision has been made. It can start. The ship's side looms almost insurmountably before us. What will await us up there? First, there's the 28-meter high ladder we have to climb to get our question answered. An uneasy feeling comes over us. Done. Klaus and the others immediately set off. No time can be wasted because we only have 4 hours before the incoming tide makes the return trip impossible. In the dark stairwell, only in the pale light of a flashlight, it's eerie. Will it hold or not? A suffocating feeling overcomes us. The incoming light creates a bizarre backdrop. The Pacific dining cable. First class smoking lounge. Cargo hold number one. The last of the two screws that were removed for the transfer. The other one sank into the sea during the attempt to bring it on board. The towing gear that doomed the ship still lies on deck. One of the two 40-kilo generators for lighting the wreck is being hauled aboard with great effort. Access to the lower decks can now only be achieved via detours, as some stairs are no longer safe. In doing so, we also find machines that have not been dismantled. On deck, cable remnants and broken glass from shattered windows. Klaus has no time for such excursions and views. He and his assistant have to connect 800 meters of cable and 90 spotlights and lamps. All of this in just 4 hours, then we have to leave the ship. Even the first class bar is to be illuminated.
Goodbye.
Here once stood the grand staircase where people would gather before dinner. outlines of the stern are still visible. One last view from the promenade deck. Klaus and his friends have finished their installation. The sound of music still seems to echo through the theater hall. One last time, the ship should shine in its old glory, reminding of the great era of transatlantic crossings, when luxury liners of the America type vied for the honor of the blue ribbon on fast journeys between the old and the new world, when the connection between Europe and America was measured in days at sea and not in flight hours. A time that will never come back.
Amidst the wreckage lies a massive object. So practically a found object, a piece discovered, in which I'm now doing this light installation, elevating it to an artwork.
I am the Lord who watches over the world.